This talk is called Tailored SNMP Monitoring, Your Own SNMP MIP and Subagent with Python and Python at SNMP Agent. So you might probably have guessed we are going to talk about MIBs and about Python. Just a quick slide about me. That's what I asked. Just a quick slide about me and about the fallacies of using OpenOffice as a presentation tool. I'm a Frankfurt, Germany-based developer, mostly developing in Python, but also partially C. I've had a mixed history in, I did the support job, I was senior intern at SUSE Consulting actually, and I was Linux system engineer at the German air traffic control. That's the nice guys making sure that your plane lands and departs safely. So I did both the dev and the admin perspective. And I've been freelancing since over 15 years now. So I've got a mixed background, just keep that in mind. So, please give me a hand. Who of you knows what an MIB is? That would have been the cheapest pun, but I've got a better one, because I am 39. Some of you are obviously older than me. Some of you are actually my age, and those of you might know this pun. Supposedly the best hip-hop album of the 90s, you're down with MIB. We're not talking about this, we are talking about this. MIB is the Management Information Base. It's used to monitor and configure devices remotely. So we're talking about a structured tree that has a root, which is actually nameless. And the things we want to monitor is obviously temperatures, fan speeds, things like that. In SNMP and in MIBs, we talk about managed objects and the access protocol on the wires SNMP. You all know that, I guess. Here's an example for a tree actually ripped off Wikipedia. So we have the nameless root, and in this example, we have an ESA branch, ORG, DOD, the Department of Defense, and so on. This is where actually we've got enterprise-specific branches. So-called MIB modules is what defines branches of this tree. Those can be generic, for example, the IFMIP for network interfaces or the TCP/IP MIP. Or they can be enterprise-specific, as is the case for MIB modules situated beneath this tree. MIB modules are defined in text files using an ASN1 subset called SMI. Who of you knows what ASN1 is? Okay. I'm not going to elaborate on that anyway. It's basically abstract syntax notation 1, which is basically a formal language allowing you to define things by means of productions. So you basically you say A equals, for example, B plus C. And a subset of this called SMI is what is used to define MIBs, but we're going to see that. What is very important is MIB modules themselves only define things, they don't implement things. So let's talk about managed objects. Every managed object is uniquely identified by a so-called OID, an object identifier, which can be either a series of numbers or a series of ASCII text labels. For example, what we saw, the tree before, .iso.org, .dod, .internet, .private, .enterprise, and then something at the end. There can be enterprise-specific OIDs, the IANA, which you probably have heard of, the Internet Assigned Numbers Authority, assigns so-called enterprise numbers. So if you want to write your own MIB, and I assume you want to, because otherwise you wouldn't be here, you might want to get an enterprise number for your enterprise there, unless you already have one. This is the URL where you can actually review those enterprise numbers. Obviously, we want a managed namespace. We don't want people to use arbitrarily chosen OIDs. Managed objects are basically categorizable into two categories of data types. We have, on the one hand, scalar objects, for example, integer values, signed or unsigned. Then there's a special variant of those integers, counters, gauges, time ticks. We have strings, octet strings, and display strings. and bit strings. I'm not going into detail what's the difference here. Network addresses, object identifiers. We're all going to see examples for these later on. And then the other main category is basically tabular objects or tables, which is basically just Scala objects grouped in tables. So who'd write their own MIP? Application programmers wanting to expose internal metrics would be an example. Suppose you're actually thinking you could beat Howard Chu to writing the next embedded database, and you're thinking you can be better than LMDB, and you want to expose your transactions per second. You might want to expose those metrics via SNMP, for example. OEMs, there's actually one OEM, Nasuni Edge Appliance, who's actually using the module I'm going to show later on. Then end users wishing to unify otherwise spread out information under a common tree. This may sound weird to some of you, but actually at the German air traffic control, we wanted to unify, to have a vendor neutral MIP that unifies information from different sources. For example, we didn't want the monitoring system to configure it specifically for Dell servers or for HP servers or whatever. And we wanted an abstraction layer in between, and that was what we did with a special MIP. Then here's the hype word InfoOps. Some guys, I think from the Netherlands, actually did DNSSEC monitoring with the module we're going to see later on. Yeah, and maybe you. So, another pun. Let's do a MIP deep dive. Let's just look at an example. This is a MIP. As I said, it's an ASCII text file, and it has a begin statement and an end statement, and obviously everything in between is defined to be simple MIP. So this is an example of SMI, and by that means also of ASM1. You can have comments with double dashes. You can actually put multiple MIPs into one text file, but that's pretty uncommon. So let's dive deeper. We have an imports section in MIPS, which is somehow comparable to if any one of you has ever done some Python programming, to those from module import this and that lines. You could say we are importing features here, for example, a feature called module identity or a feature called, I don't know, module compliance or whatever. The things we're importing from, without going into much detail, they are to a very large extent defined in RFCs. For example, there's an RFC, SNMP version 2 TC, which is about textual conventions. Here's something about conf, but that's details. As I said, this is a deep dive, so I'm going to just go across certain things superficially only. And Agent X, yeah. We'll see later. Going deeper, every MIP is required to have what is called a module identity, which is basically you do the MIP name. Notice that it's a lowercase s here in this case, so it's not the same as in the beginning where we define the complete MIP. And we say module identity, and then it's what you could call parameters, and here's the assignment. And if you look at the parameters, there's things such as when was this MIP file the last time updated, which is the organization. You can put in contact information and a description, and very important, revision information. All of this information is not really relevant to the computer system in question, but it's for people reading your MIP.
Quick question.
Yes. Good question, which I'm actually going to answer later on. But as you can see, I always said here this is wrong OID, and you could answer the question why. coming to this point, what's this? I said the MIB is actually structured as a tree with modules, and the MIB is extendable by means of those MIB modules, which we are defining here. So obviously, we're going to tell to have a way to tell the system which part of the MIB tree we are extending. And this is exactly what this is about. This is a reference and another number. So basically, we are plugging below this part of the tree with this ID. This is a wrong OID, but I'm returning later to this aspect. Very important, the module identity must be the first item after the module header and imports. Then you can do associations that make reading the MIP easier for humans. So for example, I can define simple MIP objects as an object identifier that is simple MIP plus one. Remember, simple MIP was just defined by means of module identity. So if simple MIP has this part of the tree and 3107, then this means that simple MIP objects would be 3187.1. And likewise, I can define other branches and create other aliases that refer those labels I've defined. These are actually only for human convenience. Technically, they're not really required. But if you define something like this, this must always be two elements. So not three, not one, not four. And another thing I observed was that this thing, object identifier, must actually not be part of the imports statement we saw earlier. So this is like a built-in. So let's dive even deeper. These are three examples of actual definitions of managed objects consisting of a name, the statement object type, parameters, syntax, max access, status, description, and then again, as we saw, a reference to the label I defined beforehand. So this would mean this would be dot one below the tree I'm referencing. We're defining scalar variables here. Yeah, you could say this is similar to naming files in a directory. If you consider each part of the tree directory, then this is sort of a file entry. Syntax defines the type of the managed object, of the scalar object in this example. So we have, for example, we have an unsigned 32 variable. Here's another example, an integer 32 variable. You can assign attributes such as max access, where you can say this object is read-write or it is read-only, always from the perspective of the SNMP client. I can indicate whether this variable is current or it's deprecated, it's obsolete. Deprecated would mean please don't use. Obsolete means don't use, it's not really no longer implemented. And I can put in a description, which is again mostly for humans and humanoids. So going even deeper, and this is where it gets really interesting, because tables are actually not so easy to get a grip on. Suppose we want a table like this. Three columns, index, desk, value. Then the first thing we'd actually have to do is to define a so-called sequence, which I assign the name first table row here. And I define it as a sequence of first table row index, which should be a display string, and first table row desk, another display string, and then first table row value, which I define as integer 32. What we are actually doing is we are simulating a table. If anyone has ever looked at the SNMP walk output, and especially if you SNMP walk a table, we can do that later on, you'll see that we're actually simulating a table by plugging in subtrees, and every subtree is a row, and then every subtree has exactly the number of elements of the table I define here. So for example, There could be a .1 subtree, and then .1.1 would be index, .1.2 would be disk, .1.3 would be value. And likewise, .2.1.2.2, etc. It's similar to HTML, although not exactly. Important, it is possible to have holes in the table. Another thing, in this sequence, we're actually referencing scalar objects that have not really been defined yet. Remember, we had the object type before, so this is a full-fledged declaration. We didn't see that yet. At this place inside a sequence, you only put in the name and the data type. So we still need an explicit definition. For example, for the row index here, we've seen this before. What is interesting here is that we're actually using max access in this example for tables, because the table index is actually not accessible. What does this mean? It means that if you SNMP walk the whole thing, you're actually not getting the contents of this object returned, but the index is actually merely used as an index and not as an explicitly returned variable. But we'll see that later on. Yeah, and in this example, we are assigning all of the columns read only because it's a simple example. Then, remember, we only defined a sequence so far. Then we are actually defining what you could say the table itself. So it's again a name, the object type statement, syntax, max access, status, description, as we saw for scalar values. But the difference is the syntax is now a sequence of first table row. And this first table row is exactly what we defined beforehand. So basically, we invented a new data type, first table row, which is referenced here. And what is also interesting is first table row itself was a sequence. And now the table is a sequence of first table row, so the table is actually a sequence of sequences. The table object itself and the row object defined here, again, are defined as not accessible because they merely serve as, you could say, supporting structures to realize the table. And another thing that's worth noting is right here I'm defining the first row as first table dot one. Actually, if you add further rows later on, this dot one automatically gets replaced with dot two, dot three, etc. So, going even deeper, this is an SNLP walk output. If I try to access first table itself, well, no such object available because we declared it as not accessible. Then we can see the use of the index column. You can see it here. This was what we intended to realize. You can see for yourself. So this is the SNP walk output and maps to this SNP table output. SNP walk reveals the low label structure. Again, I already said that. An SNP table especially knows how to interpret these table semantics. That's why you get the nice output here. So I don't know if any one of you is diving, but you probably know 40 meters is actually pretty deep. So as the last part of the deep dive, I just wanted to show you that you should, if you write a MIP file, you should always use the nice utility called smilint, which lints your MIP file. Programmers know this from other languages. It checks your MIP for certain things. For example, in this example output, it told me that secret element number one is not a child node under whatever. So this is like a syntax check. You should always run that, and you should also run it with increased level, then, because then it begins complaining about more details. So out of breath, enough diving. Let's define our own MIP. And if we want to define our own MIP, obviously we need something to monitor. And I thought, well, this is OSMC. Well, what could be a typical thing at OSMC we want to monitor? And who of you knows what this is? So here's a table I want to implement. Suppose there's your barkeeper or whatever, and you want to track, and there's a Peter, then there's some guy GP, I don't know who that is, and then there's a Florian, and then there's a B, and here are supposed consumptions. So this is what we want to implement. So let's write a MIP. So our MIP has the definitions, has the begin at the beginning, and at the end it would have the end. It has a comment, it has an import section. This is, of course, now really reduced to the minimum we need for our MIP. We have the module identity block, last updated, organization, whatever. Then I don't know who this is, who this guy is, JP at GG and toyersworldwide.foo.bar, no idea. And revision information. And again, this assignment. And so here's the answer to your question beforehand. Actually, we should register our own enterprise number with IANA and then put it beneath our enterprise number. So we actually somewhere below .enterprises, etc. That's actually something I learned only like recently, like after 5 years of doing this, so this kind of things. And I noticed, oh, in my examples, I'm actually doing this wrong. So that's the first part. And the second part looks a bit more complicated because, as I said, the tables are declared in a well, sort of complicated way. So we declare GT WO as a sequence. We're only using two columns, the person, which is a string, and then the consumption, which is an unsigned 32 value. It depends on who you're going to add in the table. The row person is declared as an object with syntax display string. Because it's an index value, we declared it's not accessible. It's the thirsty person's name, and it's the first entry in a row. Notice that this is actually an ASCII index, so we are not required to do integer indexes or anything. The consumption is declared as an unsigned 32 read only. It's the number of gin tonics, and it's the second element of this row. And now I have all this set up. I can define my table, which is a sequence of GT table row, which, as you can see again, is in itself a sequence. The table object is not accessible. We put it immediately as the first object in our MIP, so .1. And then we have the row object. I hope you all somehow got this. So this was the definition part. What about implementing? If we are talking about implementing the SNMP protocol, we are de facto talking about the NetSNMP suite, which used to be called UCD SNMP, found in all major distros. The current release is actually 5.8. I had to double check because I had the impression, well, NetSNMP, that's old software and maybe not like it's been abandoned, but it's not an area of much innovation anymore. But there was actually a release this year, 5.8. And for those of you who didn't yet really look at the NetSNMP package, you really should, because besides the command line application, interesting. I think it's getting darker, so it might be the battery. So if you're not seeing the point anymore, I think it's the battery. Besides the command line applications, such as SNMP get and set and work, many people don't know table, which actually comes as a surprise to me. And SNMP translate, which you can actually use to translate between, if you have a MIP file, between labels and numbers, numeric UIDs in the MIP. We also have a so-called agent, which is a software that handles SNMP requests, which is SNMPD, which is extensible, but has built-in support for a wide range of MIPs. We have a daemon for receiving SNMP traps, SNMP trap D. And what is, in our case, really interesting is NetSNMP brings with itself libraries for developing SNMP apps with, unfortunately, only C and Perl APIs. So you can see the age of the software maybe from this aspect. And there's also tools such as MIP2C, but we'll come back to that later. Now, implementing MIBs, as I said, SNMPD has a built-in support for a number of MIBs, for example, the IFMIB. So if you ever have set up SNMPD, you might have noticed you don't have to explicitly enable certain MIBs, they're just built in. But it is extensible, which means SNMPD itself is considered to be the master agent. Don't nail me on the terminology, it's not mine. And it allows for sub-agents to implement parts of the MIBs. So if we had the MIB, and we had MIB modules defining extensions of the MIB, then we have the master agent and sub-agents implementing extensions of the MIB. There are three alternatives to actually extend SNMPD. We could do proxied SNMP, which means you really just take an ordinary full-fledged SNMPD, run it on a non-standard port, the agent itself doesn't really know it's a sub-agent, and then you tell the master SNMPD to just forward to this SNMPD. The thing is, this agent needs to do the standard SNMP packet format, which is not bloated, but fully featured, let's call it this way. We could do SMUX, that's the older extension mechanism, you can, as you can probably deduce from the RFC number. Again, we have the standard SNMP packet format, but the sub-agent has a mechanism to register with the master agent, but this got issues, and I would consider this historical. The way to go is actually Agent X, which uses a more compact packet format optimized at this particular application or use case. It's got some advanced functionality, it's state-of-the-art. I always get skeptical when people talk about state-of-the-art, but in this case it is simply state-of-the-art because there's nothing newer. And you enable it with this line in the SNMPD conf. So keep this in mind if you're going to play around with Agent X. You need this in your SNMPD conf. I was talking about MIB2C, and I was mentioning that NetSNMP has two APIs, C and Perl. So if you want to do C, you actually don't have to start from scratch because there's this nice utility, MIB2C, which you just feed with your MIB you defined. And then you go through this infocom text adventure here and answer questions. For example, it wants to know, do you want to use here the old style code or new style code? And then there's different approaches to implement tables, for example. So you have to answer some questions and then eventually it will generate source code for you. One thing to note, MIB2C currently can do either MIBs with scalar values, so integers, strings, or with tables, but not both at the same time. So if you have a MIB where you want to do a table and scalar values at the same time, you would have to edit your MIB and run this twice and then merge the result. That's just a shortcoming of the MIB2C utility. And then you get something like this. This is just the init callback shown here. Here we can see what actually came out of that agent X objects definition I wrongly used before. So this would be the wrong OID, and then you see some NetSNMP internal data structures, and then it does some calls and some more calls and more calls and more calls. So you could do this. However, yeah, okay, C code. But isn't there something easier? And I do C myself, so I'm not bashing C here, right? It's just there must be an easier way because I don't want to recompile all the time whenever I change my MIB and adapt my code and stuff. So, of course, Python. Python and SNMP support. NetSNMP actually has a Python NetSNMP module, which is, funnily, 2,500 lines of C code that abstract the C API. But it's SNMP client functionality only. So you can do it to, for example, if you want to SNMP walk something, you could use this Python module. The C API, however, has support for writing agents as well, as we saw with MIB2C, because MIB2C did some calls. If you look at this again, loop, these kind of calls are actually NetSNMP library calls that are targeted at implementing agents. So the idea is, why don't we just access the C API directly from Python? And Python has a nice little module called C-types, which helps to that extent. So what we're going to do is we imitate the agents written in C. There was an existing, or there is an existing Python agent X module on SourceForge. You know, we remember SourceForge. It's still there and it's still living, but it has design issues, which means I didn't get it. Also, it's sort of orphaned. It had a lot of issues. Then in 2015, there was another module appearing in GitHub, PyAgentX, which actually does not use the NetSNOPC API, but it implements the AgentX network protocol. Meanwhile, I would consider this orphaned as well, which brings us to hello, Python NetSNP agent. So this is my module. I wrote this back in 2013, driven by requirements at the German Air Traffic Control. In the beginning, it was GPL version 3 license until like 1 year ago, when I noticed that it's actually pretty restrictive for, well, you could call it a library. So I decided to relicense it under the LGPL version 3 to make it easier to use also for commercial agents. The sources in GitHub distributable archives are on PyPy, RPMs are available on the open build service. It is compatible with Python 2.6, which means, yes, it does run under /11. You could maybe guess why /11 had to be supported. Python 2.7, of course, and also Python 3.5. If you do some Python coding, you might know that a lot of people are having the issues with Python 3. We have to convert everything. In my case, it was actually rather easy to do it. So it is compatible. It is tested also with older versions of NetSNP that, by chance, happened to be included in /11, 5.7, 5.8, no problem. And it consists of two extensively, and really I mean that, extensively commented files. There's one NetSNP API.py, which has C-type stuff for internal use. For example, I have to define things that are defined in C header files. Right, because I can't include the header files themselves, I have had to redefine them in here, which is like 317 lines of code, so not that very much, only what I needed. And then there's the NetSNP agent file, which is the abstraction classes. This is what you're actually going to include. Of course, I don't have docs yet, but I have example MIPS and agents included, which actually teach you very well. So let's look at that. Our agent. We import this module. It's the only import required, as I said. Then as a good programmer, you do, of course, have exception handling. You instantiate an instance of the class NetSNP agent, NetSNP agent, with some agent name, which is for internal use only, as far as I know. You feed it with a list of MIP files to use. That's required by NetSNP, so it can internally translate between ASCII OIDs and numeric OIDs. Then what you do is you define the managed objects you want to be implemented by your SNP sub-agent. So in this case, for example, we're instantiating a table. We have to tell it the OID. So this is sort of a class factory, if anyone of you is fit in programming. You might ask why we have to explicitly specify the table. Like, can't it look into the MIP and automatically figure it out what we're registering here? Well, first of all, we could have multiple tables, of course. And second, no one is preventing you from writing two agents that implement one MIP. For example, two agents that implement parts of the MIP. You tell it the index columns, and particularly the data types, and then the columns themselves. For example, the second column is an unsigned 32 value, and the default value for rows that don't specify a value should be a zero, which is, of course, totally unrealistic that anyone is going to drink zero gin tonics, but, well. Then our agent is really just an example, so I'm statically adding values here. Of course, this is not production-ready code. And of course, some people might argue that the values here are completely unrealistic. And then you do an agent start. This is where it actually connects to the master SNMP agent. Important, you can't register any more managed objects after this start call. Yeah, and then, well, it is an example, so I have an endless loop. The important thing here is this call, agent check and process. This is from the NetSNMP C API. It does what the name tells. It checks and processes. And well, the other thing is of course, I want the endless loop to be abortable, so I do control C handling here, and then I shut down. The thing here is, why is this not really well suited for well agents? Anyone has a clue? Okay, I guess so. The thing is, while this code is running, of course, nothing else can happen, which means especially if we didn't have static values inside the table, but had, for example, dynamic values, which we update somewhere else in our code, those updates are not going to happen while this is running. And the other way around, while we are updating values, there is no processing of SNMP values. So this is just an example. This is not what you can do in production. In production, you actually need to use threads. You would have one data update thread and one thread where this gets called, so the SNMP calls can be handled. So this is my plan B, but I want to show it live, of course, in the few minutes I have left. So I see it. So I have the MIP here, I have my agent here, and here I have a little helper script, which is nice because it tells me the commands I need to execute. And it also wraps SNMPD in a manner so it runs independently from your from any production SNMPD you're running on the system. And then we're still inside this directory because I need the MIP file referenced here. And if I execute exactly what was spilled out by my helper script, you can see here we actually really get the values. So that's my live demo. Not really fancy, but it worked. Okay. So to close the fine print. I currently have no support for a callback pattern. Callback pattern means NetSNMP itself actually supports that the moment you request a value, you get you can define a custom function that gets called and dynamically returns the value, right? I don't have support for that yet, or right now. So you need to have Python code that then at certain intervals refreshes the values you want to make actually available via SNMP. Then check and process, as I mentioned, blocks. So you need threading to do SNMP packet processing and value updating in parallel. And development has slowed somewhat because there's no active sponsor anymore, because I'm not working for the ATC anymore. Maybe this is a chance for any of you. There's a few open issues. I don't support SNMP traps yet, although there's a merge request I haven't gotten around to evaluate yet. I only have rudimentary unit tests, but it's open source, so take your chance. And that's it. Any questions?
For questions, please give me a second to reach you with the mic.
Good. Thank you very much. Just on time.
Just in time.